Hey guys, today I'm going to change out the sacrificial anode on my hot water heater. I want to thank the keyboard cowboy for suggesting that I do this. This video is going to be in two parts. The first part will take about a minute. We'll go through the mechanics of changing out the anode. And the second part, which I hope is more interesting, we'll go into a little bit of the science behind why it might be worth doing. So I've turned off the hot water and I've opened a couple of taps upstairs to release the pressure. Now I'm going to let some water out of the hot water tank so that there's less fluid there. Now I turn the thermostat down and I'm going to let some water out of the tank. We don't have to let all of the water out, just enough to take some of the pressure off. So the anode is under one of these plastic caps. You just pull that off and take some of the insulation away so you can get at the 1 1/16 bolt that's right there. All right, with some difficulty, this is coming off. Okay, here they are side by each, and it's pretty easy to see that it was about time to change this out. This is more than a decade, and that anode rod is pretty much completely eaten away. You can see that the magnesium alloy that's on there, this is the new one, the magnesium alloy that's on there is pretty much completely eroded off. Okay, we're going to put the Teflon threads on now. Hope that's in focus for you. Now, the way I remember the direction these threads go on, it's just like you're screwing it in. And the reason you want it to do it that way is because as it's screwing in, you want it to tighten itself onto the threads. And I usually do two turns. So our new anode rod is in place, and I want to show you two properties. The first is this bump on the head of the anode rod, and this bump signifies that this is a magnesium containing rod. If it were a straight aluminum, it would be a flat surface, but because it's a bump, it's a magnesium alloy. Now the second thing I want to show you is that there's electrical continuity between the anode rod and the casing of the water heater. And the reason that's important is that we want to exploit the properties of a galvanic cell. And to do that, we need to have electrical continuity between the anode and what would be the cathode. We're done. We've just changed out the anode rod in our water heater. But I think the more interesting question is, how does it work? How does suspending a metal rod down the middle of the water heater prevent rust? And why do they call it an anode? Well, this is the enemy right here, rust. To make rust, you need three things. You need iron. You need oxygen, and it really helps to have water. You think about the inner lining of a water heater, you've got all three of those elements. Now, the designers of modern water heaters use glass to line the water heater so that you don't get direct contact between the water and the iron. But as well designed as it may be, water has a way of finding weaknesses, and there are always tiny little cracks, and through those tiny little cracks, the water seeps and you end up getting rust. What else can we do to prevent rust? The chemical cascade resulting in rust formation is a little complex, but the key first step is the loss of a pair of electrons from elemental iron, a process defined as oxidation. The most popular way to prevent this reaction is to put a small negative charge on exposed iron. When the vulnerable iron has a slight negative charge, individual molecules are less prone to release electrons. And those that do so will quickly pick up free electrons before reacting with oxygen. One way to do this is to use an external source of charge using an applied DC energy supply. This process is used in the oil and gas industry to prevent rust in underground pipe. Similar devices are available for water heaters in a situation where typical anodes are ineffective. But the most popular way to exert a negative charge on exposed iron is to take advantage of the intrinsic energy of a galvanic cell. Here's how it works. Shown here is a water bath with two metal electrodes, electrically attached together by a wire. On the right is iron, which represents the iron wall of the tank. On the left is a magnesium rod. The chemical reaction that tries to happen on the right is the first step in rust formation, and the reaction on the left is a similar reaction happening with magnesium. Ultimately, this results in a tug-of-war between these two electrodes, with both rods trying to give up electrons. As it turns out, magnesium is much more prone to lose electrons than is iron, so the reaction drives electrons to the iron electrode, making that side less prone to oxidation. With the magnesium electrode losing electrons and driving electrons away, that side is defined as the anode, and the iron wall of the tank is therefore defined as the cathode. So, that's how it all works. You'll be interested to know that just about every water heater sold in North America has an anode rod of some type or other. I had fun preparing this seminar and reviewing a little high school chemistry that I hadn't thought of in years, and I hope you do too. I found a couple of links particularly useful, and they're in the caption below. Thanks for watching.